the cable to go into a Mac, you know, a white adapter. Okay, so that's what he's gonna plug into. And then there's also a white auxiliary audio cable. That's what he can plug his audio into. You can test that audio cable on your phone if you want.
Great performance. That was really good. I'm sorry. Couldn't resist. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Thank you. We're so honored that you all are here. We're really grateful, and we're looking forward to a great night. Welcome. My name is Ed Martin. We have folks that are watching on YouTube, so we're glad you can watch live and watch it on rebroadcast. We're so excited. It's our second annual Phyllis Schlafly Christmas Festival. We have this wonderful connection now to the Czech Republic, where we have these wonderful musicians who come to the United States to not only entertain us, but fortify us and help us to celebrate Christmas. I'm going to invite Father Brian Harrison to come up. He's the pastor of Our Lady, I always get it wrong, Our Lady of Victories, in near down near Sular. And so he's going to come up. Are you going to come up, Father? While you come up, I'm going to tell everyone about how great you are. He's a pastor of the church down there, and during the last 6 months of Phyllis Schlafly's life, he was a great friend of her, spending time with her, visiting with her, and he preached at her funeral when Donald Trump came with Mrs. Trump to be a part of the funeral and to visit with the Schlafly family. And he did steal the show, because his homily that day about Christian faith, service to the Lord, and Phyllis Schlafly's life is one that we still read and refer to and are so grateful for. So he's going to lead us in a moment of prayer as we begin this night to celebrate Christmas and this Christmas season. Father Brian Harrison. Father?
Let's bow our heads in prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of this beautiful time of the year when we celebrate your Son's birth at Bethlehem. We thank you for that tremendous gift, your incarnate Son, coming to share our human nature, to share our joys, our sufferings, our woes, in order to redeem and save us. We thank you for the gift of music and for our young visitors from the Smiling Strings Orchestra from Czech Republic. We thank you for this opportunity to celebrate your birth with music and with gladness. Remember your servant Phyllis, who did so much for your work in promoting Christian values in this great nation. We remember her with honor this evening. We pray that her influence, her guidance, They continue to inspire many in this great nation to work for the restoration of true Christian patriotic values. We ask this in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Now, if you'll join me, and if you're from the Czech Republic, you don't have to join me, Jill. I hope you'll appreciate it. I'd like to ask everyone to stand as we pledge our flag, which in fact is my right. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. A couple of housekeeping details before we start. We're going back to the Phyllis Schlafly Center, just a mile or so from here. Not only are there cookies there, really nice homemade cookies. Jennifer Coulter and the Phyllis Schlafly Generation Next, our youth effort, made those cookies in the last couple of days. But there are free gifts there. So gifts there. You need to come back to the Phyllis Schlafly Center immediately following. This event is funded by our organization. We ask for your support, donations. You can donate on the way out or online. This is an effort that we believe so much in, and we support our guests, and are very proud the Smiling Strings Orchestra could be with us. Just a moment before we started, Pastor and Mrs. Schust and I were talking over here, and we were saying that the reason we do this is to praise the Lord and to praise the Christmas season, but also this wonderful music is a part of our culture. It's a part of our culture. You know, we believe in contributing to politics. We believe in the importance of politics, it's true. But we know that culture is upstream from politics, and we need ourselves to be formed by these great artists that compose these works and these great artists that will perform them. And it's we believe not only is it entertaining, it'll be an important night, it'll be fun, but it's also a part of formation, forming our souls. That's the beauty that happens is an image of what God did and what his son did by becoming man with us. So it's a wonderful night. We're so proud to celebrate. And I want to introduce my friend, Pastor Michael Schust, who will be bringing the program forward. Maybe I'm bringing out the conductor. I'm not sure. They'll tell me if I get this wrong. Tonight, I'm so pleased that you are here to have this wonderful program to celebrate Christmas. The Smiling Strings Orchestra, these smiling faces. Well, they're not smiling at me right now. They're wondering why we're not starting. And Pastor Michael Schust. So thank you for being here.
Thank you. Well, good evening, friends, and Merry Christmas. I'm here to introduce the beautiful women in my family. This is my wife, Colleen Schust, and my daughter, Christy.
And this is my father, Michael Schust.
And we are really here to take you through the program and tell you a little bit more about the music, just briefly in between the pieces. Let me just start by saying that we have had this ministry for 23 years. The first group came to our church in 1995 when I was a music pastor in Houston, Texas. A lot of things have changed, a lot of water has gone by. And here we are in St. Louis. We've been in St. Louis for 15 years and have some really, really great friends. And among the top, of course, Ed Martin and Phyllis Schlafly Eagles. So we're privileged to be with you tonight. And Christy's going to take it from here.
Yeah, so the next portion of our program is music by Rachel Portman. Rachel Portman is a British film score composer. She's written film scores for a lot of films in the past 25 years or so. She actually won an Oscar for her film score for Emma, which is the film adaptation of the Jane Austen book. And she was nominated for two others, including Cider House Rules, which you'll hear some selections for tonight. They have a special relationship with Rachel Portman, this specific orchestra. She actually gave them the rights to perform her music and also to record it on their own CD, which you'll have an opportunity to purchase after the program if you want. But her music is beautiful. It really is something that you guys will enjoy. I've enjoyed it this entire time that we've been with them. A quick note about the program. At the bottom where it has all the credits for who is playing what, it says that the pianist, let's see if I can get this right, is Radek Skerzik. Yeah? Good, okay. We're actually gonna have a substitute pianist tonight. Unfortunately, Radek actually hated America so much that he had to just fly home early. That is a joke. He didn't hate America. I wasn't getting any laughs, so just so you know, he loves America. He's been here four times. But we have a substitute, and that is actually my dad, Michael Schust. So without further ado, here's some music by Rachel Portman.
We are going to go back almost 300 years. And the year 1685 gave us three very famous composers. Northern Germany brought forth the two giants of the Baroque era, Johann Sebastian Bach and then Georg Friedrich Handel. And Italy gave us Antonio Vivaldi. So here's the thing about Vivaldi. He was such a fruitful composer, and people often ask, how could a man like that write over 400 concertos, 220 of them are for strings? Well, it's because Vivaldi was a man of God, and he served in his church as a music director, and their church actually had a great ministry. They had a home for underprivileged girls, and they were just taking them as they came from the streets or orphans or whatever the Lord brought in. And Vivaldi figured, I have all these young people here, kind of like this, so I'm going to teach them how to play instruments and then form an orchestra and write for them so that we can give them a good education and they will be successful in life, and music brings a lot of joy into their heart. So he did that and wrote so many great compositions for them. Of course, the most famous, I suppose, of his works is probably the Four Seasons, wouldn't you say? Everybody knows that one. So we're going to play The Spring from Vivaldi's Four Seasons.
Thank you.
from a Broadway musical that it's sort of well known, but I don't know if a lot of people have heard of it. It's called Les Miserables. Yes? Oh, good. You guys know it. Okay, great. Okay, good. All right, so we're going to be doing three songs from Les Mis, focusing on three main characters, in fact. And the interesting thing about these particular songs are that in each one of them, the character that's singing is actually singing to God in some way. So we have Javert, who's our antagonist, and he is very much a man of the law. He believes that the only way to paradise, to heaven, is through justice and through through works and through not straying from the path. And if you stray away, then that's it for you. I mean, there's just no way back. And there must be punishment for that. And so he's singing to God, kind of thinking that he's in the right in saying that, and asking God to bless him on this journey to bring back this man who actually hasn't done anything wrong, but he believes that he will, and so he needs to bring him back, and just does not have the right sense of what grace is. Then we have Fantine, who is a young lady who has just made some poor choices in her life and has been led astray by the evil of the world, and she cares for her daughter and loves her so much and wants to provide for her, but at the same time she's making these decisions and she's asking God to forgive her, but she's not really sure if she can accept that forgiveness. And then we have our main character, Jean Valjean, and at the beginning of the show you see that he is in prison, he goes on parole, but he's still very wary of the world, he's selfish, and he only really cares about self-preservation, and until God intervenes in his life, and there's a man who shows him God's love and grace, and he's transformed in his heart. And by the end of the show, he's in this life and death situation with this young man who loves his daughter, and he starts saying to God, Lord, if it has to be either me or him, just let this young man live. If I have to die, then that's okay. Whereas you see that he would never have sung something like that or prayed something like that at the beginning of the show, and he's so transformed by the end. And so it's a beautiful image of the way that we all sometimes speak to God in our hearts, and ultimately that the best way that we can be redeemed is to be loving others before ourselves, but also to be loving God before anything else. And so here are some selections from Les Miserables.
Keeping watch in the night.
Bye.
Americans today are searching for a leader, a good man who stands on principle and can lead us to adopt the right policies for our nation. Leadership requires many important qualities, and one we sometimes overlook is that a leader must be willing to take risks for the cause he believes in. I suggest that anyone who is trying to be a leader should carefully study the character and the decisions made by George Washington. The most important Christmas since the birth of Christ was Christmas Day in 1776. That's the day a courageous, risk-taking General George Washington turned the tide of the American Revolution by his famous crossing of the Delaware River. It was a bitterly cold night, and it was sleeting. His soldiers were poorly clad. Some had no shoes. Washington's plan to cross the Delaware River and attack the Hessian mercenaries who occupied Trenton, New Jersey, risked the dream of American independence. The American troops boarded the boats to cross the river at dark, reached the Jersey side at 3 a.m., and it was 8 in the morning when they made contact with the enemy. After about an hour of ferocious fighting, the Americans defeated the well-trained, well-fed, well-clothed, and well-rested Hessian soldiers, who surrendered about 9 a.m. The Americans took 948 prisoners, including 32 officers and many horses and firearms. A British historian later wrote, "It may be doubted whether so small a number of men ever used so short a space of time with greater or more lasting results upon the history of the world." George Washington recognized God's help in his Christmas victory. He wrote his troops, "The providential goodness which we have experienced demand from us the warmest returns of gratitude and piety to the supreme author of all good." Amid all the Christmas trees and gifts and holiday festivities, let's not forget that today we celebrate somebody's birthday, somebody whose birthday is always remembered, even after more than 2,000 years. So let's take a couple of moments to recall the beautiful story of his birth as told long ago by St. Luke. "And it came to pass in those days that there went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And all went to be taxed, everyone in his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were afraid. And the angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger.' And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.' May the peace of the Lord be with you and your family on this Christmas, as we remember the reason for this joyful time of the year."
And those were the words of our dear founder, Phyllis Schlafly. And this is the Phyllis Schlafly Christmas Festival for a reason. We're remembering her and what an effort she made amid so many issues she was involved in politics, in every area of our government. She always made time to remember this very special we celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. And those recordings of her voice are just a little bit of how we remember her during this Phyllis Schlafly Christmas Festival. And at this time, I welcome back the Smiling Strings Orchestra for the beginning of our program.
So now we have some Christmas songs for you all. The first one that we're going to present for you is O Holy Night, and this is actually a tradition in our church. I don't know if we mentioned before, but my father, Pastor, well, okay, I just spoiled it, but Michael Schuss, he's actually our pastor over at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chesterfield, and there is a tradition of him singing O Holy Night every single Christmas in some form or fashion, either in our Christmas Eve service or in a concert like this. So it's kind of a nice sort of fun tradition that you all get to partake in and experience tonight. And then the next couple of songs we have are some other Christmas songs that my family and I will be singing together as a trio. So here is O Holy Night.
Praise him.
So good, right? I guess they see it. Just like to tell you something about this afternoon. You know, we came to the Phyllis Schlafly Center, and there was wonderful young people there. Jordan, you've done a great job of preparing this event. Thank you so much, Jordan Henry and the staff there. They gave us a tour, and students were able to hear something about the great Phyllis Schlafly. And it was just remarkable. You know, these are young people from the age of 13 to 19. So they were not born during communism, they were born after. And as we thought, okay, here they come from a country that has over 1,000-year history and has kings and monarchs and then oppressors and then finally the Soviets and communists and suddenly we realize, you know, America is a young country. So what do we have, some 240 years? Now imagine, almost one third of the history of the United States was deeply impacted by this Christian woman named Phyllis Schlafly. Almost one third, 70 years of great work. I cannot think of one Czech person. You know, we had some really great ones and in culture and politics and music and sports that were just so impactful in the whole world. Because when I came to the United States in 1986, President Ronald Reagan was the president, and about 2 years ago, when I sent for the Eagle Forum National Conference, I got to meet some of the ladies of Geneva. And it was just remarkable to think these are the women out of the 36 that came out to support the president, where everyone, the media, and the papers, and the politicians say, don't do it, give the Russians what they want. And he stood up, kind of sounds familiar these days, like one man against the odds. And he did what he did, and he said what he said, Mr. Gorbachev, bring down the wall. And so I'm grateful for these people, for the great legacy that Phyllis Schlafly has left. Phyllis Schlafly loved the Lord. That's what we have in common. And like the poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, she cared about what happened to this country, and she cared about the peace that this country enjoys. Well, we're going to sing a song for you that was written during the Second World War, the lyrics anyway, by the poet, Henry Longfellow, when he went through all kinds of tragedies and eventually realized that the peace that he was looking for after both his wives died, his son was wounded in the war, and at Christmas he sits there visiting his son who is wounded in hospital and hears the bells ringing. And he penned the poem that was first known as Christmas Bells. And then, later on, the poem and the song that came out of it as a Christmas song was the song, I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day. We're going to sing this song for you, and we hope that through all of that, as the history is being sung and proclaimed with the gospel of the Lord Jesus here, that perhaps the bells of this song will ring in your heart as well, that you realize, like Henry Wadsworth Longfellow realized, like Phyllis Schlafly knew, that the real peace for us in the midst of all the battles is a person. The person we know as the Lord Jesus Christ, who came down to be our peace, give us the peace that surpasses all understanding.
I heard the bells on Christmas Day. Like a choir, they're singing peace.
two centuries ago, two young men in a small village in Austria changed Christmas for all time. You might not know their names, but our world is undeniably brighter because of their actions. On the Christmas Eve of 1818, Father Joseph Moore was the pastor of a small church, St. Nicholas, with a tiny congregation in that village. According to legend, the organ of his church had broken and could not be repaired in time for midnight mass. Father Gruber had written a poem for Christmas, but he had no music. In a nearby village, Franz Gruber was an organist, a music teacher. Father Moore went to Franz Gruber and asked him to help with the music, first to write a simple tune that could be performed without accompaniment, and then to help make music on Christmas Eve. But Franz Gruber could not bring the organ to the church, but he brought his guitar. And the two men, two male voices, sang a simple song, a simple poem, accompanied by Franz Gruber on the guitar. After that Christmas, Franz Gruber gave his song to an organ builder he knew, who gave it to some folk singers who started performing it. As they traveled around Europe, they performed that song in some of the capitals of Europe and before some of the royal families, such as in Austria and Prussia and Russia, and the song became famous. But those who wrote it lived in their village and died unappreciated. And there was a time when the name of the composer was forgotten. It wasn't until 1995 when a manuscript was discovered, written and signed by Joseph Moore, with the song Silent Night, and he had written on it that the music was by Franz Gruber, and that established the identity and the origin of that song. It's a song which stands the test of time because its humble origins and its simple tune accentuate the longing in all of us for the time when all is calm and all is bright. And the story is the truth that Christmas does not need an organ, a choir, an orchestra, but only a willing heart and a desire to spread tidings of peace on earth, goodwill toward men.
Let's all sing that song together. You can either remember the lyrics or read them, and go and start on the back page of your program. That's where she goes.
Oh,
So this is the Phyllis Schlafly Christmas Festival. So let's finish this this musical portion of it before we go back to the historical house there, the Phyllis Schlafly Center, by singing together some of those Christmas songs. Feel free to stand or sit. I hope you'll sing out loud.
Christ and salt and glory.
behalf of the Phyllis Schlafly Eagles and all of us here today, to say thank you, conductor, and these wonderful young people for a wonderful performance. And in some sense, Pastor, worship, we're just so grateful. So thank you so much for being here. Let's have another round of applause. For that we do have gifts under the tree back at the Phyllis Schlafly Center. So if you go back there, you get that. And in the opposite of the sort of loaves and fishes situation, we have 450 cookies. Well, we have 435 cookies. I got into them before we came over just to sample. I didn't have any supper, though. So we have a lot of cookies, and so come on back there. Now, let me say thank you to a few more people. Our Eagle Forum Education Legal Defense Fund Board, which allows us to do all these, are wonderful people. Pastor Michael Schust and his family, especially his wonderful daughter, his two daughters, for being so great. And the Harvest Bible Chapel, his church community, does a wonderful job. Clayton High School, where we have this event, and then Jennifer Coulter is here, and the Phyllis Schlafly Next Generation Eagles. I mentioned, thank you for coming. If you don't mind, Pastor and Padre, I'd like to finish with a prayer so that we can pray one time and send forth these young people over the next few days back to their country and ask them to pray for our country. So if you bow your heads with me and join me in prayer. Father God, we thank you for the gift of these young people. We know the gift of life that you give us, and we rejoice in it. To see these faces and see their talent and see the joy, we just know, Lord, that when you bring these gifts to us this Christmas season, that is the gift. Like your son was a gift to this world, each and every one of these young people is a gift to the world they're in, to their family, to their community. We're just so grateful. And we send them forth, Father. We ask you to fill their hearts, turn their hearts to you, and fill their hearts with the joy that we have in these songs and this celebration, because Christ's coming was for each of us and for each of them, and we're just so thrilled. In a special way, I ask you, Father, to bless this nation, America, and bless our president and his wife, and protect them, Father. This man and his family are doing something for our nation that lifts you up in so many ways, and we ask you to, all across the world, to ask people to pray for him and pray for what he's doing and pray for protection and help our nation turn to you, Lord, through him and through his leadership. And protect us from the enemies and the enemy who you know is lurking even as we celebrate your son. So we send forth these young people, Father, with such a grateful heart and so many cookies to eat. And we ask you to help us get rid of all the cookies and bless these young people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you all. See you back.